We miss you so much and are waiting for you to come back to us and fill in all these seats. But in the meantime, we gather here in this place, remotely as we are. And before we gather today and begin with our devotion, I invite you to find a quiet place where you can enjoy the precious moments of peace in God's presence. To sit quietly and listen to the sounds of the world around you, both the sounds on the outside and the place where you are. And as you breathe in slowly, may you rest in God's presence. In the name of God, Creator, Sustainer, and Redeemer. Amen. This morning may you be encouraged by the words of the psalmist. The righteous cry out, and the Lord hears them. He delivers them from all their troubles. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and save those who are crushed in spirit. A righteous man may have many troubles, but the Lord delivers him from them all. Psalm 34, verses 17 to 19. If you could just call to mind, in this moment of silence, call to mind all our sins, all our troubles, and all those times that we have fallen short of the glory of God. And we confess together, Almighty God, in penitence we confess that we have sinned against you through our own fault, in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have left undone. For the sake of your Son, Christ our Lord, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and keep us in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If you could please grab your prayer book or your Bible and read together with me as we read Psalm 84. It's the psalm for this morning's office, Psalm 84. We read together. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord God of hosts. My soul has a desire and longing to enter the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh rejoice in the living God. The sparrow has found her a home, and the swallow a nest where she may lay her young. Even your altar, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Blessed are those who dwell in your house. They will always be praising you. Blessed is the man whose strength is in you, in whose heart are the highways to Zion, who going through the valley of dryness finds there a spring from which to drink, till the autumn rain shall fill it with blessings. They go from strength to strength. They appear, every one of them, before the God of gods in Zion. O Lord God of hosts, hear my prayer. Give ear, O God of Jacob. Behold, O God, him who reigns over us. And look upon us, upon the face of your anointed. One day in your court is better than a thousand. I would rather stand at the threshold of the house of my God than dwell in the tent of ungodliness. For the Lord God is a rampart and a shield, and the Lord gives favor and honor. And no good thing will he withhold from those who walk in innocence. O Lord God of hosts, blessed is the man who puts his trust in you. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Today we take our lesson from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, chapter 12. We begin to read from verse 1 to 10. It is necessary Adrian had been a seaman since the age of 11, and he had a reputation for profanity. He was known to his fellow ship sailors as a great blasphemer. He was not a man of faith, but the fear of death can plant seeds of faith in the hardest of hearts. And on that day, on the 21st of March in 1748, John Newton began to pray for his life, and God heard his prayer. The cargo shifted miraculously to fill the hole in the ship's hold, and the water stopped pouring in, and the ship was saved. Newton took this as a sign from God and marked it as the beginning of his conversion to Christianity. It would take him many, many years before he was able to give up his work as a slave trader. You see, some seeds of faith grow very, very, very slowly. But once they sprout, they bear much fruit. Newton became an Anglican priest, and he wrote a popular pamphlet renouncing the cruelty of slavery. He lived to see the English government outlaw slavery in Great Britain in 1807. But it isn't for this pamphlet denouncing slavery that John Newton was well known or remembered today. Reflecting back on that night and on how he was saved from the ship that would surely have ruined, he wrote the lyrics to one of the most beloved Christian hymns. And maybe many of us don't know the name John Newton, but we all know the words to his popular hymn. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. In the scripture we have read, Paul here is preaching to the church in Corinth. And like many believers today, the Corinthians had a problem with self-reliance and boasting. To go to the extra mile and to make a point, Paul is telling the Corinthians he has nothing to boast about except his weakness, because his weakness makes him realize just how much he needs to rely on God. He speaks about a thorn in his side that he has asked God time and time again to remove. But God won't take away that very thing that makes him realize his weaknesses. But even in that weakness, God affirms Paul that God's grace is sufficient for him. Grace is at the foundation of Christianity. By grace, the lost are found. By grace, the blind can see. By grace, God's children stand in confidence. And this morning, I want to remind you of the sufficiency of God's grace in every part of your life. God's grace is sufficient in your suffering. It is sufficient in service. It is sufficient in all places and at all times. God's grace is sufficient in joy. It's sufficient in grief. It's sufficient in loneliness. We can all rely on God's grace, which is sufficient each day, all day. And today we can also join with John Newton, who saw himself for himself personally how sufficient and how amazing God's grace is. So the next time we sing this song, may we sing it from experience. May we sing it having had known that God's grace is not only amazing, but it is sufficient. Let us pray. We thank you, Lord, for the grace that is sufficient. We thank you, Lord, that we can always hear our prayer. We now call to mind all who are sick. Gracious God, you are the strength of the weak and the comfort of sufferers. Mercifully grant to all those who are sick the help and the grace of your power, that their sickness may be turned into health. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We call to mind God's people who are in trouble and who are bereaved. Loving God, you teach us in your holy word that you would not willingly afflict us. Look with pity upon the sorrows of the bereaved and troubled. Remember your children in your mercy and in your grace, O Lord. Nourish their soul with patience. Comfort them with the sense of your goodness. Lift up your countenance upon them and give them peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the faithful people is governed and sanctified, receive our supplications and prayers which we offer before you for all members of your holy church, that in their vocation and in their ministry they may truly be devout and serve you through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. And now, as Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And so may the Lord bless us and watch over us. May the Lord make his face shine on us and be gracious to us. May the Lord look kindly on us and give us peace. We pray the grace together. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forever. Amen. Thank you for joining us.